I want you to welcome Gendy Tartakovsky. Two words before the presentation, please. No photos, no videos. And I hope Gendy is going to explain the title of the event.
The title of the event?
Yeah, which is yesterday.
Oh, today and tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
It's basically kind of a travel of my, you know, my beginnings in animation through today and possibly tomorrow.
And it's also a reference
to my favorite comic book store when I was growing up in Chicago. Thank you for coming out. It's always coming to Annecy or Annecy, however you say it. It's always very special because I know in France everybody loves animation. And of course, so do I. So it's always a pleasure to come here. So I have a lot, probably too much to show, but I'll try to go through what everybody knows faster and get to all the new stuff that nobody's seen quicker. So like we were saying, in 1977, I came to this country, and all I knew of animation was this. And this is called Ne Pogodi, which in Russian kind of translates to wait till I get you now. And it's like a Tom and Jerry ripoff. Of a wolf trying to get this little cute bunny rabbit. And the wolf smokes and kind of talks like Tom Waits. And so we immigrated to America. My father bought us a TV set. And all of a sudden, I turned it on. And here was Tex Avery, Warner Brothers, you know, Daffy Duck, Popeye, the world of Hanna-Barbera, Tom and Jerry. And I fell in love with animation, probably like most kids do. But for me, I never outgrew it. And one of the things that you'll start to recognize as we talk about my career a little bit are these four things: relationships, luck, a lot of hard work, and kind of seizing an opportunity and not wasting it. Those are the kind of the big things that I learned. You'll probably forget all of them after, but maybe one of them will stick, and they mean a lot. So right away, I went to Columbia College after finishing high school, and I didn't even know I wanted to study animation. But I knew I couldn't work at it, and my family didn't have a lot of money, so I wanted to make a living. So I thought I would do films on the side and do advertising art. So as fate would happen, and luck maybe, or fate, all the classes, art classes that I wanted to take were closed. And all of a sudden I saw an elective class called animation. I didn't even know they had it. And I was like, wow, maybe I'll fill up an elective credit and then learn about what I love to do. And when I got in it, my first teacher was Gordon Sheehan. He was 90 years old. He was an old Popeye animator. And he was about this high. And I fell in love. I knew that I could not do this for a living, because he still drew like that old Fleischer style in circles. And he was amazing and very inspiring. And I realized I couldn't not do it. So this is never before seen. One of my crappy, horrible drawings. I was 18 years old, and I never had a great talent for drawing. I had the passion, but my brother was 2 years older than me, and he even drew better, and it always frustrated me like crazy, because he didn't care. And so I made this little Bruce Lee thing. Then I made my second year. So this is all on cell paint, and the guy's eyes aren't there, so it was like backlit, so it was all in the camera. I made this little film, also very horrible. You can see in the drawings, it's not very good. So this is Stumpy's Gang, which I made for a play. And during the play, this animation came up. I stayed up for 4 days straight painting the cells. They were all over my mother's apartment. And it was quite an experience. But again, it's kind of that hard work that kind of got me through it and the passion that I had for animation. So luckily, those two films, a box of sketchbooks, not sketchbooks, a box of flipbooks, I sent to CalArts. And somehow I got in. And when I got there, I realized it was a mistake. Because I was already 2 years studying animation, studying drawing. And then the first day we put up our assignments, and I was blown away. I thought somebody made a mistake letting me in this, because everybody drew so much better. You know, Craig McCracken, Lou Romano, Sergio Pablos. Those were the caliber of people that were in my class, and I didn't belong there. But I studied hard, I worked twice as much as everybody else, and maybe this one, not so much, but things started to get better. And this is my first student film, Muffy Meets the Mafia. And fully animated, very kind of Tex Avery style. And it was starting, I was starting to get better, and I had a knack for timing and animation. These were the first drawings of Didi. So this was done at CalArts, my second year film. My first year film was 4.5 minutes, but all black and white, not like this amazing goblin stuff that you guys are doing. It's crazy. It looked like this. And my second year film, so this was my drawings of Didi, and here's some roughs of Dexter. So you could see how far he went. And then I brought my student film. So this is Dexter's Laboratory, called Changes.
At last, my greatest work completed.
Ooh, what's that?
What are you doing in my laboratory?
I'm just here to keep you company.
I do not need any company.
Ooh, what's that?
Huh?
Ooh.
Ew. You're crazy.
What does this button do?
Please, please, don't push the button. You have no idea what it does. Now, look at what you've done.
Ooh, look what a cute little bunny rabbit.
Let me go. Have you any idea of what you've done?
No.
Well, let me show you. What do you want to be more than anything else in the whole world?
Ooh, I want to be a beautiful princess with long golden hair and a big red bow. And I want to live in a big, big castle and have lots and lots of horses.
Now do you understand that by combining the positive and negative polarities of cerebral...
Thank you. I ran out of time to finish it, but because the first year I did 4 minutes of finished animation, that wasn't great. So then I spent, you know, only doing maybe a minute and a half. But it was successful and people liked it. But I never thought of it as as something that would be a show. I just thought this is a funny idea of a little kid who is a scientist and a girl who dances in his room, and just for fun.
Ooh,
this was what based on it after.
Do. Please, please, do not push the button. You have no idea of what it does. Ooh, look what a cute little bunny rabbit. Let me go. Have you any idea of what you have done?
No.
Well, let me show you. What would you like to be more than anything else in the whole world?
Ooh, I want to be a beautiful princess with long golden hair and a big red bow. And I want to live in a big, big castle and have lots and lots of horses.
So I jumped ahead a little bit, but basically by doing the first changes, or you know, Dexter's Lab in school, this is kind of where the relationship started to happen. And Sergio Pablos, who came from Spain, invited some Spanish producers to what's called the producer show. It's at the end of the year, all the students show their work. And they liked my film, they liked my animation, and they invited me to come live in Spain and animate. And I was like, you know, I was 22 years old, and I was like, yes, a big C. And they were doing Batman, the animated series. And I got there, and it was extremely difficult. It's hard enough to draw the characters, much less animate it, and do it on a TV schedule. Sergio, of course, was doing it flawlessly and very easy. But for me, I struggled through it. I was there a lot of nights. And I actually found a couple of scenes that I animated, so you can kind of track my animation. Like in the short, the little Dexter pilot that we did, I ended up animating probably more than half of it. Because I never thought it was going to be a series. I always thought I could just use it for my reel to get another job. But here's a couple of scenes from Batman.
Of course I will help in any way I can, Sensei. But what made you think of calling me?
You cannot hide the warrior spirit behind your playboy image, Wayne-san. Kyodai Ken returned from America in defeat.
He was beaten by Batman.
So it is said. Perhaps I thought you might somehow enlist the aid of this Batman. You know him, do you not?
We've met.
So that was probably a week's worth of work. And I just remember, like, every time I watch it, you know him, do you not? I just remember trying to get that gesture right, and it looks terrible. But from Spain, that finished. I went to Colossal for a little bit, worked on some commercials. And then, again, the relationship's kind of working well for me. I became good friends with Craig McCracken at CalArts. He got hired at Hanna-Barbera on Two Stupid Dogs. And then he brought me over. And it was a great experience where what was happening was this is pre-Dexters, and everything that I did as a storyboard person, they would change. Everything that I thought worked was wrong. And so when I got the opportunity, so then I left and I did The Critic, which was the same thing. Everything I was doing, they just didn't believe. I was doing a good job, but I wanted to try creative things, and it just wasn't happening. And then I got a call from my producer, my old producer from Two Stupid Dogs, and he said, Gendy, there's a thing starting called Cartoon Network, and they want to make shorts. I remember your student film. Do you want to make a 7-minute thing out of it? And I was like, yes. And so I came in, and this is some just, I have a little bit of Dexter stuff just because it's fun to see how far it grew. But this is some of the early drawings later on. He looked quite different. And of course, I made Dexter. They liked the short. It got an Emmy nomination its first year. And then they got a series, and it started to grow and become more successful. We finished Dexter, and then Craig took the reins as the creator, and I was a producer-director, and we did Powerpuff Girls. Then I was tired of that, and then it was time for Samurai Jack. And Samurai was, you know, after doing, I guess, almost maybe 6 years of a lot of dialogue for Dexter and Powerpuff, it's definitely some action and the big, thick blackout, you know, black line work around everything. I needed to do something different. I always complained about action shows, so I go, okay, I'm gonna do an action show the way I see it. So stylized visuals, visual storytelling, little dialogue, artistry combined with badass action. And that's kind of how I pitched it to my boss. And we had a great relationship. He trusted me. He trusted what I was doing creatively, and he just said, go for it. And we made a test first, and so this was the first test of how Samurai would look and feel. So samurai wouldn't have been samurai with the people that we started working with. I have too much stuff, but you could just see some of the designs that we started to work on to try to get a lot of Craig Kelman drawings, who's one of my favorite designers who was working at the time. Just trying to, this Paul Rudish, trying to figure out, and when I did this drawing, I go, ah, that's what it should be. You know, these kind of funny, goofy, serious aliens versus a samurai. This was my first drawings of a coup. You know, very different. And then kind of started developing it until who he became. Some more Jack drawings. And so the main kind of keys on Samurai Jack were some of the art direction. And there was a guy, Scott Wills, and Dan Kroll. Dan drew the backgrounds and Scott painted them. And here's some of Dan's drawings. And this is like the first thing kind of we did. Like Dan started first, he was doing these kind of drawings, really dynamic. And then Scott came in and then he did that. And he really combined, like Dexter was very flat for me, but Samurai was the first use of lighting that I did in a graphic sense. But he brought this great mood. Again, here's some great Dan drawings. But it was the magic of those two guys together. You know, and Scott's color was, I've never seen anything like it. And to this day, we've still been working together pretty much on every project through Popeye and the next one coming up. This is one of my favorite pictures. All his little thumbnails. And he used to paint it, all this stuff was done by hand, so it's pre-computers, which was even more amazing. So, okay, blah, 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 great stuff. Okay. There's too much. I couldn't even pick because I love it all so much. I brought a clip, but I feel like we don't have time. you guys have seen it, right? Yes, okay. So what brought us to Clone Wars? And so a quick story that was pretty interesting is that I was out with my boss, the same guy who greenlit Samurai Jack, and he goes, he was from the South, so he goes, Gandhi, we might have Star Wars. And I go, what do you mean you might have Star Wars? And he said, well, basically, the truth of it is that Hasbro, the toy company, has a multi-million contract with George. The movies didn't do as well as and didn't sell as many toys as they wanted, so they kept begging George, we need more content in between the movies. So in between Clone Wars and Revenge of the Sith. So he goes, fine, you can do something animated, but you can only do 1-minute episodes. So they had a relationship with Cartoon Network, and then Cartoon Network came to me, and so my boss goes, you can do 1-minute episodes of Clone Wars. And I said, well, 1 minute, those are like basically commercials. I don't want to do that. That's too much work. It's not worth it. I go, at least 3 to 5 minutes. So they go, okay, but you know, George doesn't want to budge. So they went back and they go, well, we have Gendy and the team from Samurai Jack. And George said, oh, I love Samurai Jack. They can have 3 to 5 minutes. So that was great. So then, and then just so you appreciate the time of it all, we had 2 weeks to develop everything. So basically, Paul Rudish and I sat together and we're like, we're both Star Wars fans, and what are we gonna do? We both kind of froze up, and then I started to think about, you know, I'm a big fan of like war stories and stuff, and I read a lot of books, and like I have this great World War I book over tells from the letters of the soldiers that were there. And I go, why don't we do that? We just do experiences from the Clone Wars, and that way we don't have a big story because we had all these rules. And so Paul did a bunch of the drawings, I wrote it up, went to San Francisco, pitched it, they showed it to George, and George goes, fine, don't bother me again. And that was that. Second time around, because his son really loved it and they were, you know, successful, then he called me to San Francisco, which was amazing. I had lunch with him, we talked about Star Wars, and then he wanted me to introduce General Grievous. And so here's a little clip of that.
I can't see anything.
That noise.
He is coming alone.
We can't face him!
We must try, Padawan. It's close, but where?
It's all around us.
Calm yourself. Steady. Steady.
No! Some of the proudest stuff that I think that we've done. And it's funny, because looking back at all this stuff, one of the biggest motivations for me doing anything is to animate it. So a lot of that fight stuff I actually got to do myself, just because it was so much fun. You know, a giant guy fighting eight Jedis. I mean, can't get any better for animation. So anyways, and then goodbye Cartoon Network. Things went kind of not wrong, but everything changed, and it was time for me to go. I wanted to do movies, and I got fortunate, and I started my own studio. And it was right at the worst timing possible, where the whole recession happened everywhere. And so we raised enough money just to last for a few years, and we developed some great things. This Vikings movie, and this, no, I don't think I've ever shown this stuff. And it was before How to Train Your Dragon. So like, we had a lot of these ideas too soon, I guess. But it was about these brother Vikings, and one loved war, and one loved farming and family. And they separated, and there was this great story. Very cinematic, very dramatic. It would have been great. So again, Scott Wills, Paul Rudish, a lot of the same guys were me. During the time, Chris Maldondri called, and he just started Illumination, and he wanted to develop a dinosaur movie. So we started to develop this dinosaur movie that became, I think it came out last year, Walking with Dinosaurs, but we had it with no dialogue, and the animals acted like animals. And it was a story of these two guys and their kind of journey. It's kind of like Land Before Time, but with no talking. And it was going to be really exciting, and I thought it would be a great first feature for me, but things kind of fell apart, and I had to move on. So to fill, I never did any commercial work through all my time, my own, you know, 15, 16 years. And then we were running out of money, and I had to do some commercials. So we did some quick ones. I'll just show a couple of them.
You want to quit, but giving up all your cigarettes at once can seem impossible. That's because the receptor beasts in your brain will put up a fight if they don't get their hit of nicotine. With Nicobate's new Pre-Quit, you can continue to smoke for 2 weeks. The therapeutic nicotine reduces your urge to smoke, so you can gradually cut down and quit for good with Nicobate Patch. To triple the chance of success, Ease into quitting with new clinically proven Nicobate Pre-Quit.
And thanks. The best thing about commercials is that 30 seconds cost almost as much as a Samurai Jack episode. Just to put it in perspective. Anyway, so more commercials. We'll just skip through those. We got to get to the good stuff. Okay. So I did commercials. We were running out of money. Features weren't doing well. We wrote some scripts, but things just too hard to sell. Mistake I realized is we were trying to sell ourselves as a company rather than just as a director and a movie. And all the studios want to make themselves the brand name or the stars. They don't want to help me make my studio great. So so then I came back to television and sold Symbionic Titan. And again, same people, pretty much. Another great experience. Well, scratch that. Super frustrating, because now all new bosses, they don't really trust me. The whole thing, the whole vibe changed the Cartoon Network. And basically, because we didn't get a toy license, they didn't want any more episodes. Doesn't matter the creative. We were starting to get our audience. The show started to get off, but it just wasn't happening. Do you think I have time for a clip? All right. So this is one of my favorite episodes. We were taking TV, again, pretty much same budget as Jack, as Phineas, is probably less than Phineas and Ferb or whatever that show is. And, but what we could do with it, because we had the best people and we were all working together and we were grooving. And this is the Roar of the White Dragon, where basically Lance, who's one of the main characters, meets the street tough and they race cars.
Over yet, Chan.
Got it.
Stop doing that. Fingers away from the eyeballs. Hey,
So after Titan, we came to Hotel Transylvania. And I stepped into a movie that was being developed for 6 years, five different directors, maybe even longer. And I saw the potential in it, but it was a mess. And it was going all these different variations, which all had their good and bad things. But when I got there, I realized nobody is kind of standing, standing behind what they're doing. Kind of some kind of a conviction, I guess, or confidence in what they're doing. And I think a lot of, you know, there's a lot of movies that are made and very few directors. So I think the feature director job is very coveted and very hard to get and hard to keep sometimes. But for me, I kind of had nothing to lose. I thought, well, I could always go back to TV. And I realized this is a really messed up situation. So all I did is I kind of put this train on the tracks and push it through. And luckily, it worked. You know, and it was a big fight. Creatively, it was fun. I had a great team, and it was fun making it, but that's kind of what I felt I did. So relationships, so important. You know, our industry is very small. I run into the same people all the time. Luck, being at the right place, right time, I can't help you with that. Hard work, you know, I talked at USC a couple years ago, and a kid goes, "How do you work so hard?" You know, and I couldn't believe this question because this is, you know, we're not mopping up floors, we're not washing dishes. This is what we love to do if you're in animation. And it takes a lot of work and commitment and to get better and to get good. Don't waste an opportunity. If you have an opportunity and you don't have time for it, make time for it. You know, when I didn't like something, I redid it at home in my own time, and I got so much out of it. It's crazy the benefits you get out of kind of doing something for free sometimes, or on your own, you know, you just like, you know, for Two Stupid Dogs, they did some walk cycles. They hired an animator to do it, and I didn't like it. And I redid it overnight, and then I showed my boss. He's like, "Wow, these are great. Here, do this opening, animate the opening main titles," you know? So taking an opportunity got me an opportunity. And point of view, you know, really just focus on who you are. And it's a hard thing, because sometimes nobody's going to want your point of view. But you got to believe in it, you got to try to sell it, and become a salesman. It's hard for us because we're kind of introverted sometimes as animators. We, you know, we're artists, we kind of draw at our desks, and we're comfortable with that. You have to get out of your own skin and present yourself, talk in front of people, sell yourself. It's a big, big deal. I hope the translating is going well. Yes, good, thank you. And, you know, that's kind of it. I mean, I rushed through everything, but it's so much work, and I hate to skip over everything. But I'm sure you'll have some good questions. So thank you.
Just watching your clips, I was wondering if you prefer 2D or CG?
I mean, it's simple. Yeah. Of course, 2D. I think we've forgotten how beautiful drawings are on the screen, especially this big, you know? I remember sitting when I was 15, watching The Jungle Book for the first time and just being blown away by the art of it and the drawings. And it's so, there's something about something being very hand done. It's somebody's personal personal point of view, their expression, you know? And even though CG is great and I've embraced it and we're doing some really fun things and we're pushing it, there's still nothing like somebody's drawings because it's purely them. It's not a machine, you know, changing everything. It's a different pencil, it's a very fancy pencil, but there's something about hand drawing. To me, just personally, it's subjective. You know, you can't argue that CG looks amazing with all the detail and stuff, but there's some simplicity in it that I think is missing.
There was a question over there. Yeah.
Hi, just, I never do this, but I'm gonna be the one with the two-part question. I'll make it quick. Sorry, part one. So Symbionic Titan, I heard you say you wrote 10 more episodes for season 2 that were never produced. Is there like any chance the show might be rebooted, or otherwise, can you just leak them online? Is that like possible? I'm just kidding.
I think, I don't know. We did write 10 more, and they were getting better. But I think, you know, with Netflix, Amazon, and Hulu, and all these places starting to do television, I feel like there could be a place for it sometime.
Cool. And the other thing was just, Like, I know the Samurai Jack movie was like almost produced a bunch of times, and I wanted to ask, like, is there anything from it that was like produced, like a test or an animation test or something? And otherwise, is there still a chance it might be made someday?
It's always the first question, so luckily today it's the second, third question.
I am sorry, I'm predictable.
That's good. We have some drawings, not a lot. We have a lot of scripts. I probably have 4 or 5 different versions of it. And there's still interest. I mean, you know, we did Jack in 2001, I think, when it premiered. So that's already 14 years ago, and it still comes up. It's still kind of loved. And I think one day we'll make it. I don't know when, but I'm still trying. And, you know, it was at Sony for a little while, but then as soon as Sony bought it, all the executives shifted, and now it's gone again. So we'll see. It's just the way of the world, and, you know, but I'm still fighting for it. Thank you.
Here? Hi. Mr. Tartakovsky. Here.
Yes.
At the beginning of your presentation, you showed us that your influence were like Tex Avery, Hanna-Barbera. However, when I was when I was little and I watched Dexter's Lab and the Powerpuff Girls and Samurai Jack, there was a lot of Japanese animation influence. Because my favorite episode of Dexter's Lab is the one they do a rip-off of Speed Racer.
Right.
How does
rip-off? That's all right. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Yeah. Yes.
How does Japanese animation influence you on writing, on screenwriting, on directing cartoons?
I mean, I definitely grew up with it too. You know, it was a lot of the, you know, Speed Racer, Battle of the Planets, and Miyazaki. Those really are the main ones that I really connected to me. And they do influence me. I think, you know, you kind of put all those things together, and also with a lot of live action stuff, and you mix it all together and it influences me. It's all in my head, and I never try to refer to it. You know, the Speed Racer one was just fun. We wanted to do an episode of people actually talking like they used to dub the cartoons that wacky way. And so, it's just something that's inside. I don't know how it directly comes out, but I know actually, like we were talking earlier about 70s filmmaking with films like The Sorcerer and The Conversation, those films influenced me in a much different way also. So it's kind of, you put together Apocalypse Now and Bugs Bunny and Tex Avery with a little Miyazaki, and then you get what I'm trying to do, I guess. It's hard to define what you do.
You never spoke about the comics. Was it an influence on your work also?
The comics were drawings, for sure. I used to love just buying, comics when I was growing up were drawn simpler. Mm-hmm. You know, Jack Kirby, Frank Miller, John Byrne, those type of people. And I would just try to copy it. I would just try to learn how to draw. But I knew even at a young age, I'm not good enough. And I remember this kid in eighth grade, he used to draw so well, like humanistic figures. And I was like, wow, if he's the same age as I am, and I'm nowhere near like this, I realized I can't do this, even no matter how hard I try. There's a limit, you know. And then when I got to CalArts, it was the same thing. Like, I saw people who were naturally talented. Like, their parents were painters or artists, and I wasn't. I come from a, you know, just normal people. And I just, I knew there's a difference. I knew no matter how much I worked, I could never really get to this level where you're truly just gifted. And I have, you know, I don't want to downplay myself. I'm good at a lot of different things, and I have a good knack for timing and storytelling, but it's not this natural thing. There's something, you know, that it's just, you know, they've been drawing like that since they were 12.
Okay. And Mr. Tatakovsky, nice to meet you. I want to know how was received for the studio when you brought all the cartoony stuff to this. I know that Sony is going for is embracing all this cartoony stuff, Tex Avery, more than other studios. And how is, for all the pipeline, maybe the riggers must get crazy with these media frames and rubber arms. And
yes.
ImageWorks do a lot of VFX, realistic stuff, and they need to work with this cartoony stuff. So how it was for all the studio to change it all?
I think Sony didn't know what I was going to do. I think I kind of sprung it on them. And to be honest, ImageWorks, who does all our work, they were fantastic. In the first movie and second movie, it really is completely outside of what they did. There were, you know, some cloudy people that kind of understood what I was going for. But yeah, definitely, it's such a hard movie style to animate because I believe in the funny drawing method. You know, like if you could draw it funny, you should be able to sculpt it, you know, or manipulate the model enough to make it look like that. And then what I was trying to sell to the animators, I go, you know, you can watch a Bugs Bunny cartoon and you can isolate who did what scene because they all drew differently. But in an animated movie, there's a homogenized feel to it all, right? It all looks like one puppet. And so I wanted to break that mold, and then, you know, one guy drew Drax's eyes kind of small, another guy drew him big, another guy drew really funny hands. And that really started to come out, and all of a sudden you saw these superstars of animation rise because suddenly they were expressing themselves in the animation, you know? And that was so exciting for me to see. And also it was a way for me to animate because I draw a lot over the poses, and it was kind of, I can't animate on the computer, I tried, it doesn't work for me. But yeah, it was very difficult, and yeah, the first movie, they built all the expressions. They remodeled them, and they blended all these shapes and stuff. They really tried hard. Second movie is definitely a little bit easier, but it is challenging, for sure. Actually, when we first started pitching movies, when we started my own studio, we went to Sony, actually. And we had this thing called Periwinkle, which this guy, Aaron Springer, created, and I was helping him try to make a movie. And they loved it. They wanted to do it, but then they said, we don't want to put your studio logo on it. And my partner said, well, we're not doing it, you know? And then I was like, oh, but what if we just do one? And, you know, my name's still on it, and I'm part of the studio. It'll just get us help. And as a company, we decided not to. And I think if we did that movie, the whole thing would have been different. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe they wouldn't have liked it at the end of the day. But that's probably the only one that I kind of look back and regret.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.